A year ago, it was generally assumed that the question of amnesty for draft evaders and deserters was closed. It isn't, in fact. There are several reasons for this, some that might be anticipated, others that could not have been. The polls show that although there is still considerable sentiment against unconditional amnesty, the majority opposed to amnesty of any sort, while it remains a majority, diminishes in size. A second factor is the troubles of President Nixon, who, as the most prominent spokesman for the intransigent opponents of amnesty, suffers from the diminution of his own reputation as the representative of an unleavened view towards law and order. And finally, in Congress, several bills have been offered key to the question of amnesty. Mr. Ramsey Clark is prominently associated with what one might call amnesty at any price. He believes that the deserters and the draft evaders, subject to whatever qualifications he may wish here to elaborate, should be reintegrated into American society. Mr. Clark is, of course, most conspicuous in this particular quarrel as one of the Americans who traveled to North Vietnam during the war and reported on the benevolence with which our POWs were being treated by the North Vietnamese. But his concern for amnesty is not a particular concern for Americans who ran afoul of the law during the Vietnam War. He is also associated with Amnesty International, and of course he was Attorney General of the United States during the last years of the presidency of Lyndon Johnson. He served in the Second War, graduated from the University of Texas, took a law degree at the University of Chicago, entered government service as one of John Kennedy's bright young men, and is the first American to serve as Attorney General whose father had served in the same post. Indeed, Tom Clark, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, swore in his son as Attorney General. After Mr. Nixon's election, Mr. Clark wrote a book, Crime in America, and went to New York to practice law. He has resigned from his law firm in order to contend for the Democratic nomination for senator against Jacob Javits, a senior Republican senator. He has gathered most publicity for refusing any financial contribution in excess of $100 from any individual. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Clark whether he believes in selective subjugation to laws in general or only in respect of military service.
I think laws must have uniform and equal application in all walks of life. I think we have to recognize, though, that amnesty is a use of law itself. It's an exercise of constitutional power that was delegated by the people, both to the president and to the Congress, that justice might be done, recognizing with Thomas Aquinas that an unjust law is a law in name only. Therefore, it's an opportunity to constantly refine and purify the law and do justice.
Well, I think that the point you make is an interesting one, namely that a society is mechanically empowered to grant amnesty. And in point of fact, the Constitution of the United States mentions amnesty only as an executive prerogative. And the point has somewhere been raised, not very convincingly, I think, that only the president, only the executive, can grant amnesty. But as I understand it, the Congress of the United States would have the right simply to order that no prosecutions be undertaken in pursuit of a particular offense. This is correct, isn't it? And you would call that amnesty.
Well, that would hardly be complete or adequate amnesty. For instance, that wouldn't help people already convicted, would it? It couldn't reach them. It wouldn't.
How could Congress mechanically free people who had been convicted and were serving time? Is there a way they can do that?
It can, certainly. It can grant legislative amnesty, I think, without question.
Has it been done in American history?
It has been done primarily under the executive power.
None of that. I say, has it been done by the Congress?
Yes, it's been established by the Congress. Take World War II, where the Congress established a review board for the conferring of amnesty, and that necessarily was based upon legislative power, but when you think about it, it's unthinkable that the Congress would have the power to make the law and not the power to change the law that it makes, or to change the effect of past laws, or to undo the effect of past laws.
No, but you brought up the complication, and I'm interested that you did so. I'm asking you whether Congress could pass a law that said, for instance, nobody involved with Watergate is going to be prosecuted, or and those people who are already in jail because of a Watergate offense ought to be released. Is that possible?
I think it is, sure.
I see. And therefore, they could do the same thing as regards the deserters.
They have, in my judgment, necessarily and inherently plenary power, full power, to grant absolute, unconditional amnesty for resistors, people who refused to obey the Selective Service Act, for deserters, people who left the armed services, and for the 450,000 young men and the few young women who received less than honorable discharges.
Okay. Now, you began by observing, in response to my question, that the quote unjust law is only a law in name, quoting Thomas Aquinas. Thomas Aquinas, of course, did also say, did he not, that one is obliged to obey the law or to give it due respect, except insofar as it violates conscience, right? Now, provisions always existed in America for people heeding their own conscience to refuse to fight, but not to refuse to accept alternate duty. Is it your point that Thomas Aquinas' observation is or is not illuminating as regards this?
I think it's illuminating, but it's hardly adequate to to cover this point. First, it's quite a distortion of our history to say that refusal to serve on account of conscience has always been fully granted. That was fought out with great difficulty for very few people during World War II. And how do you really distinguish between the child of a very religious family and a poor kid brought up in the ghettos of America who doesn't realize till he gets to a place like Indochina that he doesn't want to kill? He had no opportunity to be a member of a religion or have some conscientious scruple about it. But that's not the question either, Bill. The point is that the Congress has the power, regardless of conscience, to change the law.
Mm-hmm.
And if it wants to do, as does the president have the power under the Reprieve and Pardon Clause to grant full amnesty.
Mm-hmm.
And if they want to do a decent, important thing for this country so we can get on with living together and solving problems and not unnecessarily creating suffering for ourselves, they'll move toward absolute, unconditional amnesty for these hundreds of thousands of people whose lives are so badly and unnecessarily continuing to be damaged by these laws.
Yeah, Mr. Clark, we all know that you're in favor of amnesty, and we've settled now, at least I think we have, that the mechanical question which is sometimes raised by simply taking your word for it, and I think it's plausible, that Congress can do it if it wants to. But now I revert to the original question, and the original question is very simply this. Do you believe in amnesty only for people who refuse to serve when called to serve, or do you believe in amnesty for people who refuse to do other things that they don't want to do?
Well, what other things are you talking about? Oh, what other laws do we have?
Pay taxes, eh?
The amnesty that I've been addressing myself to and the one that I assumed was the subject is the amnesty that I feel should be conferred on all those people who, for any reason or no reason, if you will, refuse to lend their time and energies to this war in Indochina, whether it was by way of desertion, whether it was by way of refusing to serve in the military service.
Just that war?
I would do it for all wars, yes, but those are the
all
those
wars.
Are the
okay. So therefore, you believe that in any war, people ought to be entitled not to serve. It's not just that war.
all past wars.
How about all future wars?
Well, we have to take those as they come.
Well, I'm asking you, do you or do you not lay it down as a general proposition that selective objection to war ought to be grounds for automatic exemption from any law of selective service?
Oh, I would I would say that both the selective and the general opposition to war should be grounds for an individual
Okay, then future wars too. Okay.
Well, but you can't mess up the law. If the law, you can't, what you're doing is repealing your future power to make laws to conscript people for the military service, so you're really getting an ambiguity. Amnesty, by definition, only applies to past acts.
Yes, but an amnesty that applies to past acts ought to be animated by a philosophical principle. In America, it is not, I think, widely enough known. Amnesty is very definitely not a tradition.
I think they might have been a historical argument about that.
Well, there have been fitful acts of amnesty. Lincoln granted amnesty to people who took an oath of allegiance. Roosevelt granted amnesty to people who pulled out of the army after the fighting was over in the First World War. Truman granted amnesty to only 10% of the 15,000 people, and only on recommendation of the Amnesty Board in 1952. No amnesty was granted at all after the Korean War. So by and large, you are urging a new view of things. Now,
we could start with the beginning. George Washington granted amnesty to those who participated in the Whiskey Rebellion and shot at federal revenue, as you might say. John Adams, Thomas Jefferson.
I'm talking about amnesty for failure to serve.
Well,
I'm not talking about amnesty for drinking booze in Kentucky or anything.
It's not drinking booze, it's for taking up arms against those who would enforce the booze laws, so to speak.
Well, amnesty for refusing to serve or deserting from the Army of the United States.
Well, you'd still have to go back through and you'd find a dozen presidents. You'd find Jackson, Ulysses S. Grant. Mm. Of course, Johnson, Andrew Johnson, Abraham Lincoln,
doing what?
Teddy Roosevelt.
I can name presidents
granting
too, but tell me what they did.
Granting amnesty. No. I thought that's what we were talking about.
No, they didn't grant amnesty for people refusing to serve.
They granted amnesty to men
who were involved in
infractions of military rules or regulations or selective service laws during conflict.
Are you talking about categorical amnesty, or are you talking about commutation of sentences?
Talking about categorical amnesties of groups, not all that were involved.
And what did Andrew Jackson do?
Andrew Jackson granted amnesty to men who refused to serve in the War of 1812, in which he was involved as a general.
In the War of 1812, what exactly was involved?
Well, as you recall, we had a few skirmishes. Jackson fought behind the cotton bales down at New Orleans. The capital here was burned. We were fighting the British. There were American soldiers engaged in conflict in many places. Andrew Jackson, Old Hickory, tough military officer, as President of the United States, granted amnesty to some of those men.
Yeah, now, he was President of the United States 14 years after the War of 1812.
Elected in 28.
Yeah, that's right. So that, are we discussing a question whether amnesty should be considered in 1987 for the Indo-Chinese people now?
Now.
Was Andrew Jackson in favor of granting amnesty in 1814 or 1815 or 1816?
Well, we don't know, but I would hope that our capacity for compassion would exceed his and that we could act more quickly. Under any circumstances, he didn't have the opportunity till he was sworn in 29, and he did.
Well, he had an opportunity to be as active on the subject as you are, and perhaps even more so because he was a presidential candidate, as we know, 4 years and very nearly made it 4 years before he was actually ushered into the White House. But what I'm trying to find out is, are you taking a position that really relates to the experience of the Vietnam War, or are you taking a position that relates to a newfound relationship between the citizen of a free country and the fighting of a war? You seem sometimes to be saying the latter, but it seems to me that your animation is the former. You didn't like that war, and you really want retroactively to honor people who declined to serve in it, don't you?
Well, I think that that might be their due. I certainly don't think they ought to be punished for being right about the war, but that's not really what I'm talking about.
What about giving them a medal?
Well, we...
Suppose Bella Abzug enlarged her pending bill and said they should be given amnesty and $10,000 and the Congressional Medal of Honor.
Well, I think you're more prone to value medals than I am. I would prefer giving them justice. Why not give them justice? Why do we want to
cause suffering? I believe in reward, don't you? And if in fact these were the true heroes, why shouldn't you reward them? I mean, why not be completely frank about it?
Well, I guess I think it would be good if we were that big, but some of us aren't, perhaps a majority. And in the meantime, I would settle for justice for those men. I think we need it for them worse than they need it for themselves.
Why do you say
frankly.
Justice? Why do you say that? Because justice is defined normally, I mean, in democratic society.
There's no normal definition of justice. Well, I've worked with that for a long time.
maybe you're citing your own difficulties as Chief Justice Enforcer in the United States. But by and large, justice is the impartial treatment of people under the law. That's how most people understand. If there's a law that says half the people in this room who are under 30 have to serve, then the impartial administration of that law is justice.
All you're talking about is impartial administration. Is impartial administration of evil justice in your definition?
Absolutely.
No.
Absolutely. If you say that... taxation is evil. After all, our revolution was in part a resistance to taxation. It is definitely more just to tax equally than to let some people get away with no taxes at all.
No, but justice is more than equal injustice under law. It's equal justice under law, and you have just defined the equal aspect of it. Justice is, in Aristotle's phrase, doing acting with virtue toward others. But you know, this is semantics.
Yes, but the definition of virtue in a democratic republic is unfortunately not received by listening to anybody, even as oracular as yourself or as myself. The law is defined by a series of motions that end up in the Congress of the United States, sifted through the Supreme Court of the United States, receiving some sort of constitutional benediction.
In terms
of the law in question, it survived all of those tests, and two of them while you were Attorney General of the United States. When a motion to the Supreme Court was denied with only a single member dissenting to question whether or not the Selective Service Act was constitutional. So therefore, we have to assume that to the extent that the Americans are empowered to define justice, justice is defined as saying that John Jones has to do what James Jones was supposed to do, or suffer the consequences.
Well, you shifted your definition from justice to law, and there is a difference, and that was the difference we began with when I quoted Thomas Aquinas. And of course, the Supreme Court's decision was not on the merits, as you know, but on whether they had jurisdiction to even consider this matter, and they decided that they didn't have jurisdiction because it was a political matter. It was a matter for the Congress for the President, and that's why I think the Congress should now act.
Therefore, it was the law of the land.
No, the determination of what the law should be, but amnesty is law. That's the thing you don't want to see, and you can change the law. That's why the Congress sits.
Now, but you're the one who started using justice and the law interchangeably. You said it would be just to extend amnesty.
That's right.
And I say that justice, most regularly understood, is the impartial administration of the law. Now you say, well, the law can be an unjust law, sub specie itinitatis. I will agree with you. A lot of the laws under which I labor and you labor, I think, are lousy laws. But so long as I live in a free society that is democratically governed, I have very little alternative than to obey those laws or to declare myself an exile from that society, which some of these people who have gone off to Sweden, 4,200 at the last count, 600 actually at last count, have done.
Well, a worthy citizen has a higher obligation than that, and that's to try to purify the laws, try to refine the laws, try to make the laws just. That's what democracy is about, and that's why we keep going.
Well, but subject to certain rules. Should he come back and assassinate the President? This would be a very direct approach to tyrannicide. Is a very direct approach to getting rid of the guy who's giving you unjust laws. But you don't approve that, do you?
I can't see any relevance between that and this conversation. I don't know where you got idea.
I'm suggesting that the minority who are dissatisfied with the law and are urged to do something about it have a range of choices. I want to eliminate those choices that you and I would agree to eliminate. One of them is presumably assassination. Another is terrorism? How about terrorism?
I'm against violence altogether, and that has nothing to do with amnesty. Amnesty arises from quite the opposite group of human emotions, if you will. It arises from compassion, from the desire to end suffering, from the effort of people to reunite families and to do justice and to seek to develop a political, legal conception of compassion.
But in point of fact, Mr. Clark, the figures right now suggest that the majority of Americans would not be united by the granting of amnesty, but would be disunited on the ground that they feel that this was a treacherous act towards those members of American society who who followed the law.
First, I'm surprised to hear that that your judgment comes from polls, but because I have very little regard
for polls.
No, not my
judgment. I'm not talking about.
Second, where do you find treacherous in there? Where do you see treacherous? I don't see anything about treacherous in there. I think some people are afraid of it. Some people don't understand it. It's a new issue. We've just gotten our sons and our prisoners of war back home, and now we're either going to walk away from this thing and forget it and leave hundreds of thousands of people crippled through their lives in the sense that they won't be full participants in this society or perhaps any other, or we're going to have the moral courage to face up and say, we want you to have a full life. We want you to be a free participant in this open society.
Well,
we're granting full amnesty.
In the first place, it doesn't follow that necessarily we'll have a full life. 20% of the ones who are going to Sweden are going to jail in Swedish jails, not for violating American laws. So it doesn't follow that by opening the gates of Ellis Island, they're going to have a full life, number one. Number two, it may very well be that by doing this, you diminish to some extent the lives of other people. Diminish the lives of other people in one very simple sense, that they believe that they have been retroactively robbed, and that under the circumstances, you sow disharmony and diminish the possibility of the majority having satisfactory lives. It seems to me that a compassion has got to be granted by people who feel primarily aggrieved. You don't feel aggrieved, I don't feel aggrieved, neither of us fought in that war, but I think that we should have a certain respect for people who did fight in the war and ask that they primarily should inform us on the subject, shouldn't they?
Well, I don't really think that, no. Nor do I get my sense of morality from algebra, where we're told that two negatives make a positive. Suppose there was injury, as there obviously was, to many who served in the war. Look how damaged so many are. Look at how difficult it's been for so many who served to reintegrate into this society. Look how cruel and selfish we have been in terms of our veterans' rights to them compared to the veterans' rights that you and I received from World War II. That's shameful. But punishing those who didn't serve is not going to help these men. And we have to understand there'll be plenty of suffering in this life without us causing it, and we have to be generous enough in our purpose and just enough in our efforts through government to want these people to be united with their families, to want them to be able to live a full life if they're capable of it in an open society.
Well, but I don't understand why you fail to reckon with what I consider to be not by any means a misanthropic response. You've often said and written, I've heard you say it, that one of the causes of great bitterness in the ghetto is that the undereducated, discriminated against member of minority group sees himself going to jail for committing a particular offense, but the rich white guy defended by Edward Bennett Williams for getting off. Now, I've always thought that was a very good argument for seeing that the rich white guy shouldn't get off, not for letting off the other person, if in fact he was guilty of mugging or rape or murder or whatever. Now, I'm asking you, how come your concern for shared justice at one level does not extend to your concern for shared justice at this level?
It does, precisely, and all you've done is flip the equation. You see, in your first hypothesis, you have premised your argument on the fact that people in the ghetto were committing crime and being punished, mm-hmm. and people with wealth and power were embezzling and things like that mm-hmm. and not being punished. Yeah. And I think that equal justice requires it all be punished. Now,
right.
if you're going to say that...
Or not punished.
Well, they should be,
if it's going to be equal
treated
justice.
Equally
right,
under
right,
the law.
Right, yeah.
But that doesn't mean that... Now, to me, then, what we do with the veterans who served is we give them meaningful benefits. And to those who refuse to serve, we give them the full opportunity to live a normal life here in America. We don't seek to punish them. We don't blight their lives. We don't drive them from this country where we've got probably 40,000 living in in Canada now, unable to come home, unable to see their families. That makes no sense. Equal treatment there would mean that we try to deal with the human problems and the human needs of both groups in a just and generous manner instead of in a punishing or in a demeaning manner.
Well, but as I understand it, you have consistently come out not for legislation that says, okay, to the guy in Sweden, you can come home, but when you come home, you've got to face 2 years of service in whatever, the Red Cross or whatever. You are in favor of unconditional amnesty.
That's right.
Now, therefore, you aren't attempting to carry forward with any rigor your notion of equal treatment.
Well, I don't know what you think equal treatment is, but if you think that it's been a picnic to be a fugitive from your land, to wonder how your own parents and your brothers and sisters and your former best friends feel about you, to be lonely and isolated in a foreign country, then you don't understand what these people have been through.
I
hear them say that the hardest decision, and I believe this, the hardest decision they've ever made, and I suggest it's a harder decision than you or I have ever had to make, and we've had to make some pretty hard ones, was the day they decided to leave their country in pursuit of what they believed justice and humanity. And to say that they should come back after all these years and engage in, if we'd had that at the beginning, if there had been a meaningful alternative, but there's no question now as to whether there's going to be alternative service or not. It's going to be exile or amnesty for many. And in addition, we've got hundreds of thousands here at home underground. The Federal Bureau of the Census estimates that 10% of the male population reaching 18, its 18th birthday in 1972, failed to report. My God, that's a couple of hundred thousand young men in 1 year wondering whether if they cross the street and get arrested for jaywalking, it's going to be discovered that they didn't register and they'll be prosecuted.
Oh, come on, Mr. Clark.
Look, exactly
the war has
is.
Been over a year and a half. Lots of people have crossed the street in the last year and a half. And how many indices do you have of people who, while crossing the street, have been arrested as a result of their falling into this
figure? There have been a few, and cases have been brought there. Probably 5,500 prosecutions pending right now. There are at least 35,000 referred from Selective Service alone to the Department of Justice for determination of prosecution. There are, out of the more than 500,000 who deserted during the 10 years of our direct involvement in Indochina, there are more than 30,000 still at large. That's an enormous sea of humanity that should be liberated from this suffering and burden.
Well,
it makes no sense.
It
hurts this country. It hurts our dignity. It hurts our humanity.
Your figures, as you must know, are inflamed. That is to say, they don't coincide with the figures either of the Pentagon or of the Justice Department.
Well, let me hear what you think their figures are. I think these figures are exactly right. I don't argue facts because you can't prove a fact by argument. But let me hear what you think the figures are.
Well, the figures.
I've looked at the figures. These are the figures.
The figures, as given by the Pentagon, estimate between 4,200 and 6,000 people abroad, and somewhere in the vicinity of 24,000 to 30,000 people at home. Now, they recognize, of course, different categories of offenses, but
they don't recognize.
Of course they do. For instance, you can't say that somebody was a deserter unless you can prove to a military court-martial that he had never had any intention of rejoining
Well, they're charged with desertion all the time.
Well, sure, they're charged with desertion, but it becomes their responsibility to prove. What do you lawyers call mens rea in a situation like that? And in any case, the figures I give you are the official figures, but let's not deal with it macrocosmically. You say, these people are unhappy, A. Maybe they are, maybe they're not. Lots of people, I don't think it necessarily commits you to unhappiness to go live in Canada. My wife was a Canadian and came to live here, and she's, I hope, happy. Point number one.
It's a pretty traumatic experience.
Point number two, this is what they're elected to do. And point number three, when they come back, they presumably come back in order to face certain consequences, which were the law of the land at the time they left. You say, let's simply eliminate this because you anticipate that by doing that they'll be happier. To which I can only reply, it is not obvious that they will be, nor is it obvious that the country would be.
Well, I think the country would be. I don't think that I gave their happiness or anybody else's happiness.
Why do the polls disagree with you? Even though they've come down 10 points.
The polls are changing. We don't have...
They've come down 10 points. I started off by saying that.
Yes. Well, you didn't start off, but you did say it.
It's 58% against unconditional amnesty, 20% in favor as of March.
Yeah, and there's a strong current shifting. We conceive of the war. It's still going on, but we conceive of it as just having ended, and amnesty wasn't an issue until we got our last troops out, as it would be very difficult to be, and I think you'll find a steady swing. But in the main, people haven't thought about it yet, and people need to think about it, and they need to have the facts. And many of these young men and many women will not come home. But I think for our own conscience, I think to show that we're unafraid to hear them and to have them home and to have them in our midst, to show that we understand the compassionate use of law and to give families a chance to live together in a world that has plenty of suffering, we ought to open up the gates of America and say, come on home. That war is over. We are going to forget those offenses because we believe in justice and we have the power to control our destiny through law.
Well, you've said that, and I understand that it's well-intentioned. What I'm trying really to get from you is a philosophical framework for your position. Now, there's no question that the ACLU wants amnesty for one very simple reason. It wants a backdoor way, historically, to declare the war unconstitutional. Henry Schwarzschild, who's the head of their amnesty department, put it this way: America owes to itself and to all the war resistors the enactment of universal unconditional amnesty. The ACLU believes that the American involvement in the war in Southeast Asia was unconstitutional, and the compulsory military service carry on that war was unconstitutional, i.e. this is the way, therefore, historically to vindicate that position. Now, is this partly your motive to grant amnesty so as to declare your solidarity with their initial decision to skip?
No. No, nor do I really think it's Henry Schwarzschild. In logic, obviously, to grant amnesty does not establish the unconstitutionality of the war. It's unrelated in law. My bases are first human interest. I think we've got to recognize these statistics involve one human being at a time. And we ought to act with compassion. We ought to give them a chance to come back to this country. We ought to say that this country wants them back. We love them. They're our sons. We need them.
Well, should we say that to Vesco?
Well, if you're going to make such absurd comparisons, did he violate the Selective Service Act?
No, he violated another law. Uh-huh. But I want to know why I should be more sorry for the guy who fled to Sweden because he didn't want to fight in the war than I should be for Vesco, who fled to Nicaragua because he stole.
Well, because there's a difference between refusing to fight in a war and stealing. It may be too simple for you to understand.
No, it's too complicated for me to understand.
No, never that.
It would explain to me. I'm saying
you don't see the difference between
there's a variety of motives that cause people not to fight. One motive is that they're against the war as a moral question. Most of those people stayed home and waged Martin Luther King or William Sloan Coffin type objections to it. They stood there and they spent nights in jail and so on and so forth. Others simply took off. They were looking after their skin, some of them. Now, treated as a category, I don't know why I should be any more sympathetic to the guy in Oslo who took off rather than do his duty here, than for Vesco, who took off rather than pay his taxes? Why should that be?
Well, it's pretty obvious, and I'll try to explain it if you'll listen carefully.
I will.
All right, point one. Mm-hmm. We confronted them, we the people, through law, confronted them with a very difficult decision, an unjust decision, an unnecessary decision.
I know difficult. Now, don't say unjust.
I say unjust.
Why
shouldn't I say unjust?
Well,
because it was unjust.
You're stealing a base.
I'll steal a base if that's what you call it. I say it was unjust because I say that the war was wrong, because we shouldn't have confronted these young people with that choice. We didn't.
Why in the hell did you serve as Attorney General for the man who led that war? Why didn't you tell Lyndon Johnson it was unjust and quit, rather than sit around as a member of his cabinet giving orders all over the United States if you thought you were serving an unjust man?
I didn't give as many orders as you indicated.
Well, not enough, I know, but you certainly gave some.
I gave some.
You were his right-hand man as far as justice was concerned. Now, all of a sudden, you tell us he was serving an unjust man who was waging an unjust war.
I said the war is unjust, no question in my judgment.
Why did you say it then?
Well, maybe I did, but my judgment is...
Well,
to
it wasn't
the,
very resonant. Why didn't you quit?
I didn't think that was the way to achieve what I hoped to achieve for this country.
Well, did you get up in the Cabinet room and give speeches and say, Lyndon Johnson, you're an unjust man, Mr. President?
I'm not particularly... a speech maker. What I believe an attorney general has a responsibility to do is to
enforce the law.
Enforce the law or resign.
Well, did you prosecute? Did you prosecute people who failed to go to the army, though called under the law?
Sure, certainly.
We Why did you prosecute? Well, that's what I mean.
And now I want to change the law because that law was wrong and unjust. Certainly retroactively. We got something about history that's sacred that we can't change it when it's wrong or unjust or unwise or not good for people.
I can't understand why.
Why are you so reluctant to face up to our power to control our destiny, to do justice? We can help these people. We can help ourselves. We can say we're unafraid.
We've traversed that ground. I granted that it's mechanically feasible, but I'm asking you why we should all of a sudden proceed at your level of moral erudition on this basis. There wasn't anybody in this room or in America who was more responsible than you for prosecuting people who dissented from service in the war. And all of a sudden, a few years go by, and you want to grant retroactive vindication to the same people that you prosecuted. Is it because you have a personally bad conscience about it that you want us to share? Because I don't share it. I think you did the right thing.
No, I don't have a personally bad conscience about
it. You just finished telling us an unjust law, and she prosecuted.
But that has nothing to do with it. I want to do justice now. Is that so unthinkable to you that a person can't want to do justice now? He's
no.
got to psychoanalyze
himself.
What's
unthinkable to me is that justice becomes that which you define as justice.
Well, what else do we have to guide ourselves?
Well, we have Ramsey Clark of 1968. Ramsey Clark of 1968, as Attorney General of the United States, wasn't telling me or anybody in this room that it was unjust.
But does that really have
anything to prosecute the laws that you were prosecuting? So all of a sudden it's your sunburst that you want us all to share. Well, I respectfully decline. I don't
think
everybody
was
a moral idiot except you. I think that the American people have a very good sense of impartial justice, and that they want people coming back from Sweden and Canada to put in a little time in order to.
No, you don't know that they really think that, and I don't think they really think that, and I think we need to think about it, and we haven't thought about it, and we need the facts, and there is absolutely no good served by seeking to do that. Young men are not going to come home to face alternative service, and we need unconditional amnesty now. And whether I was right or wrong in 67 has nothing to do with the merits of amnesty now. If you want to address the merits of amnesty now, let's look at where we are and what we're doing.
You were going to tell me why Vesco shouldn't be allowed to come home.
Well, Vesco stole money, perhaps. Who knows?
He failed to pay taxes.
He ought to come
suppose
back.
Suppose he thinks those are unconscionable taxes and cites George Washington to somebody.
If you really think that all laws are the same, why, we do have a problem. I don't think so.
I think some are very bad laws, but that all laws, as long as they're on the books, should be obeyed or withdrawn or repealed.
Yes, but do you think the tax laws ought to be repealed?
I think some of them are dreadful, and so do most members of Congress. Okay. They're always talking about repealing
And
laws.
I think you ought to be working to repeal those
laws. I wrote a book about it very recently, which I invite you to read. I'm not going to ask, meanwhile, for you to head up a committee to absolve me from having to pay those taxes that I consider unjust. Though probably you would, which is the nice thing about you.
If I thought it was right, I would.
Yeah, that's the problem, to cause you to think it's right, isn't it?
Well, what do we have beside our judgment?
Well, you have some respect for what Burke called the democracy of the dead, which is the settled institutions by which decisions are made in this country, the Supreme Court, Congress, local democracy of the states, and the notion that what they have to say, however objectionable it may be, is really the spinal column of a viable free society.
Well, I think that change is the fundamental fact of our time, and that the principal role of the law in our time, if we are really to survive, much less merely solve problems, is that the law become an effective, sensitive, responsive instrument for social change, constantly examining through democratic institutions changing conditions and applying new rules to meet new human needs.
Which is what you're attempting right now.
Which is what we're doing with Amnesty.
And if you're rejected? If the people reject you and Congress rejects you, what do you say? It's a lousy society?
Or
that they don't want your change?
What you're opposing is the alternative to say and do nothing. I refuse to accept that alternative.
No,
this is a democratic society.
I'm saying
you
that
speak your mind, you fight for what you believe is right, you adhere, hopefully, to constitutional government and the rule of law.
But change is not in and of itself good. It may very well be that to do nothing is the correct thing.
On occasion, but not often these days. If you look around, I think you'll concede we need some change.
Well, this is a terrible slur at people who created the laws under which we now live, generations of Democratic congressmen.
Well, it may seem like a slur to you. I don't function at that level. I just say that we need desperately to achieve change through law to improve the human condition here, and that amnesty is an essential part of that, not just symbolically, but in terms of the lives of hundreds of thousands of people directly, and through them, millions of their family and friends.
Do we need to change the Bill of Rights?
I like the Bill of Rights.
I wish that, that should not change.
I think the Bill of Rights is in pretty good shape. There are a few changes that I would make in it, but not...
Just sort of brush it up a little bit.
Yeah. I don't find many things perfect.
Mr. Joseph Arnick is an attorney here in Washington, D.C., Mr. Arnick.
I'd like to remind you, Mr. Buckley, that we have had amnesty in other connections. For example, in the Civil Rights Act of 1964, Congress and later the Supreme Court, in interpreting it, effectively gave amnesty to the many demonstrators throughout the South who had engaged in trespassing and other illegal acts to challenge what they regarded as unconstitutional segregation laws.
Yeah,
and I think we did that.
I'm talking about amnesty for refusal to serve.
Well, but I think we did that for two reasons. First, that the demonstrators we thought may have been right about the underlying issue of segregation versus integration. And two, I think because we thought, what was the point of continuing after we'd passed the civil rights laws, of continuing to punish those people who had demonstrated as they did? And isn't it the same in Vietnam? I think all of us have an uneasy feeling, some a very definite feeling, that the people who didn't serve were right and that the people who ordered the war were wrong. That's one.
Well, in answer to your question, no, it's not the same.
Even if you're not sure about that, you have the second feeling, that what is the point of continuing to punish these people who are in jails or in Sweden or what have you? And the only reason I've heard you give, and I'm much baffled by it, is the sort of speculative psychological damage that it might do to those people who did serve in Vietnam or those parents who lost children. And, you know, it's very, very speculative compared to the damage being done to somebody who is actually in prison or somebody who is exiled from his country. And I'm rather surprised to see you give such weight to some speculative psychological damage that may be done to some Americans over the obvious and real damage that's being done to others.
Well, I don't think it's speculative, because I think that one's commitment to democratic method and to the rule of law is, in a sense, an abstract a commitment. Just as my automatically stopping when I see a red light is, in a sense, anti-rational, it is nevertheless my commitment to the notion that unless I do so, I tend to undermine a system of which I am the beneficiary. And what I'm simply saying is that if you simply change the law through amnesty or whatever means in order to give you retroactive satisfaction as regards a particular target group, you must be aware of the potential consequences of that category.
Amnesty or other means, you slip in the other means. What Mr. Clark has stressed is that amnesty is a process by law. It would be no different than if today saying we made a mistake with the income tax. You wouldn't regard that as so terrible. Indeed, you'd love it if Congress would get up and say, we made a mistake with the income tax, and therefore we're repealing it. All legislation in that effect
would
have a retroactive effect. We have made a mistake. We made a mistake in punishing these people as long as we
I don't think we did make a mistake. See, now that the majority of the American people, I don't believe that the selective service law was necessarily a mistake. I prefer voluntary service and have 25 years ago was when I first came out in favor of it.
The issue
but,
is whether
but
the application
I don't,
of the
I don't
Selective
deny the
Service
right
law
to
was
the
a
state.
Mistake in this context, whether applying the Selective Service law to people in the context of Vietnam was correct. Now, of course, we can argue forever about whether you think it was right, you think it was wrong. What Mr. Clark is saying is that this issue should be brought before the American people and that they should have a chance to understand the issue fully, and only
no.
by majority rule,
no,
they
not.
Should give amnesty. Well, how else
no,
is an amnesty
not.
Bill going to be passed? It's
he's
not going to be passed by minorities. It can only be passed
no.
by the majority of the American people asking the representatives to do
he's
so.
He's saying a great deal more than that. He is saying if the American people were just, if they were compassionate, if they were truly moral, this is what they would do. And I'm trying to get in the way of those slurs against the majority of the American people.
And you have
don't
not
want unconditional amnesty. Only Bella Abzug and three others have so far come out for unconditional amnesty.
And you've yet explained why he's wrong. All you said is that some people might feel
well,
upset by it. You have not yet shown
no,
why
I have explained. Whether you have understood is another question.
Well, I think your explanations have
well, unsatisfactory, sure. I'm resigned to that judgment. Miss Susanna Lessard is on the staff of Washington Monthly and the New Yorker magazine.
Mr. Buckley, how important is the problem of future conscription in your position? In other words, if we could assume, safely assume, that there would be no future wars or that wars would be manned by very few people, for instance, would that affect your position?
No, it would not. It would affect my position as prudential a question, but it would not affect it as a moral question. I think that the moment to grant amnesty is when the American people desire to grant it for reasons of their own, and that this is a judgment that in part reflects an anticipated requirement of total mobilization, which in an atomic age is very slight, but mostly nothing of the sort.
I see. Mr. Clark, you seem to be saying that we should grant amnesty because the Dodgers and deserters were right. And this upsets me because it really seems to run counter to the whole spirit of amnesty, which is a way of rising above and saying that we are not totally the prisoners of our own concepts of right and wrong. It seems to me that by saying that, you automatically infer that the people who went were wrong. And that is a position which I certainly, although I deplore the Vietnam War and I certainly am for amnesty, I couldn't possibly take that position. My sort of question is, don't you think that by stating this, that you jeopardize your own cause by making it almost impossible psychologically for those people whose sons died or were grievously maimed in the war to accept your position? They are the people who should give amnesty, ideally, spiritually speaking, should be the parents of people who died.
Well, I see what you're talking
about. It's
a
messy question, I'm sorry.
No, it's a perfectly clear question, and I let me say first, you read too much into what I said. There are, of course, Gold Star mothers who are ardently concerned that we have amnesty. Louise Ransom, whose son was killed in Vietnam, is devoting all of her time, essentially, to full, unconditional amnesty. And while it's true that I believe the war was wrong, and that, therefore, those who refused to serve were right, I think, regardless of that, we should grant amnesty. But it's that much more important, if they were right, that they not be punished for being right. But we ought to grant amnesty because there is no human good served by a continuing diminution in the ability of these people to live full, normal, integrated lives in the American society. There is absolutely no good to be served by that. They ought to have a full opportunity. We ought to want them to have a full opportunity. They can make contributions here. They may teach us something about peace and war that we need to learn. So whether the war was right or wrong, they should be granted amnesty, all of them, and given the chance to come home if they will. But I do think it necessarily follows that if the war was wrong, it's that much more important that we try to correct injustice that we've done.
I don't see that it really has that much connection. I mean, if one imagines the speech made by a president, whoever he may be, saying we are now going to give amnesty to all these people, don't you think, and you have described the need for amnesty in terms of the psychological health of the nation almost more than the needs of the people who are in exile,
that's
since
fair.
A lot of them won't
yes,
even come
that's
home.
Fair.
And imagine, in writing, if you were to sit down to write that speech, wouldn't your main problem or challenge be to achieve a level of eloquence and profundity which you could deal with the fact, the almost unbearable fact, that many young men died in this war, which was a tragic mistake, and we're now bringing these people back, that you could handle those emotions? I mean, it's emotional, and it's an emotional powder keg, this thing, and I don't see what's served by so strenuously emphasizing how right these people were and how much we have to learn from them. It doesn't seem practical, if anything else.
Well, maybe it's too important an issue to be entirely practical about. To me, the real reason is that amnesty is a decent thing to do. It's as simple as that, and we need to do a decent thing for a change in this country to show that we care about humanity.
What do you mean for change?
We want justice. I mean, we haven't been doing too well lately in this country, if you hadn't noticed.
Well, you mean by not electing McGovern, that kind of stuff?
Well, that's one of them, yeah. I didn't want to politicize your program.
I'm glad that we have a definition of decency now.
Now, you always turn to politics, not me. I think, though, when you look at our foreign policy, all the things that led us into Indochina, impel us still. Look at Chile or South Africa or practically any place else. We support tyranny around the world, and that's too bad, and amnesty is directly related to
that. On the contrary, we oppose tyranny primarily throughout the world. We've spent more money than any country in the history of the world in an attempt to oppose tyranny, unless you consider Stalin and his successors non-tyrants, in which case your discussion should be with people like Solzhenitsyn and the Russian Jews who are trying to get out of there and ask them whether they think we're supporting tyranny through such things as the Jackson Amendment.
We've been
and the $80 billion that
supporting that tyranny too, when Dr. Kissinger and others tell us it's purely a domestic affair. I've tried to.
And you don't think it's a domestic affair?
I certainly do not.
You think we should go to war with the Soviet Union?
Of course not. I don't.
Maybe we can
war.
Get those people in Sweden to lead the vanguard.
I don't think we ought to give them preferred status or sell them wheat at such favorable prices when they're hungry people in other parts of the world. And I think we ought to say that we have a moral outrage here at home in these United States the way they're treating the Jewish people in the Soviet Union.
How about the way they're treating the Christians in China? Are you in favor of doing something about that?
I think if we've got evidence any place that there's tyranny, as we have evidence in so many countries.
How about if they're treating American POWs badly in North Vietnam? Should we do anything about that?
I think we certainly should.
Oh, well, maybe we should have a war.
I don't think war is a solution. I wonder why you do.
Well, it sometimes rescues people, doesn't it?
Not often.
Well, we had
it
a war.
Hadn't worked very
we
well.
Got our POWs back under a Nixon leadership, not under a McGovern leadership or a Lyndon Johnson leadership, right?
That's correct in the sense that Richard Nixon was president when they returned.
Yeah, well, that's the relevant sense, I think.
A number of years after they could have been gotten back, and at what cost to humanity.
Well, especially since they were leading such pleasant lives.
No one ever said prison was a pleasant life, but anyone who knows anything about prisons knows the more they're visited, the better the prisoners will be treated.
Mr. Frank, Donatelli is the National Executive Director of Young Americans for Freedoms. Donatelli?
Yes, Mr. Clark, you spoke of conscience earlier, and you seemed to indicate that when one violates the law, if indeed one believes the law to be unjust, then he should be free from the penalty in certain cases. I'm wondering, regarding the draft dodgers in Vietnam, what about those who left the country not because of conscience but because of other reasons? So far in the discussion, there seems to be a prevailing assumption that everyone who left the country rather than serve was some kind of saint, and they're pining away in Canada or in Sweden rather than leading fruitful lives. What about the guy that just wanted to save his own skin and didn't really have any moral considerations one way or the other? Does this amnesty, should it apply to him also?
Well, let me say first that you try to read much more in what I say than is there. I think when people violate the law, they ought to assume that they'll have to pay the consequences of the law. I think the people that have the power to make the law and change the law should always seek to do justice and to provide laws that create decent conditions for humanity to live in and end suffering. And therefore, amnesty is something we do now, not a state of mind that they had then or could have now with any consequence. In other words, amnesty is the act of democratic institutions seeking to do justice.
So conscience has nothing
unilateral.
To do with this.
Unilateral. There's no remorse required under your definition.
Conscience has nothing to do with it.
Remorse has nothing to do with it. Conscience has nothing to do with it. You can't read people's conscience. It's very hard to do, and it gets you into a demeaning game. The fact is that whatever the reason the person left, suppose it was cowardice, which I doubt. What kind of a country is it that punishes cowards? Is that the kind of business we're in? You're a coward, we're going to punish you? Isn't cowardice punishment enough itself? But in the main, it took a lot more courage. Took a lot more courage not to go than to go, if my experience in America gives
me any basis for judgment. So how is a coward really different from Vesco, Mr. Buckley was talking about?
Well,
Vesco wanted to save his own skin, and you have a draft dodger that wants to save his
own
skin. There's no matter of conscience involved.
Nobody told Mr. Vesco that he had a choice.
Oh, he had a choice to pay taxes
either,
or not.
Well, he was trying to make a lot of money, wasn't he? And he was, in fact, engaged in a whole, as far as we know, he was engaged in a whole series of operations, including influence of government and other things like that, that he was alleged by a federal grand jury to be crimes.
He was trying to beat the system. He was trying to beat the system, right? But so was the draft dodger.
Well, he was trying to beat the system for his own economic good because of his greed. They were trying.
Obviously, it's to be economic good and not to be killed. Mr. Dontelli's point is, don't you distinguish between the two?
Oh, I think, I really think there is absolutely no comparison. To try to make a comparison between Vesco and a draft resister is just ridiculous. We confronted a young person with an opportunity, if you want to call it that, to go or to face consequences as a matter of law. He wanted to live his free life unimpaired with that obligation. This had nothing to do with him, any violence in his character. It had nothing to do with any greed in his character. Mr. Vesco, apparently, and I don't know enough about the gentleman or the facts to conclude, he wanted to be rich, and he didn't care about the laws that have to do with that.
Thank
it was
you,
his greed that got him into this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Clark, and ladies and gentlemen of the panel, and ladies and gentlemen of American University. Thank you.
For a printed bound copy of this program, send 50 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 50 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by grants from the Laurel Foundation and the Ford Foundation.